At the end of the day, he loves me. At the end of the day, at the end of the day, he loves me. At the end of the day, at the end of the day, he loves me. At the end of the day, at the end of the day, he loves me. Everybody say it, say it.
At the end of the day, at the end of the day, he loves me. At the end of the day,
let's go.
At the end of the day, he loves me.
Sing at the end of the day.
At the end of the day, at the end of the day,
put your hands in the air.
Good evening and welcome, my friends. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it indeed. I am so glad that the Lord has kept us up to this day. And up to now, the Lord has been of our help. And for that, we give glory to God. Amen. There are so many of our siblings who could not wake up with life this morning. And there are many who did, but there are no more. There are many who would have loved to be in this world, but they're not. And so I always have a tendency to believe that there must be a reason why God is still keeping me alive. There must be a mission. There must be something that God wants me to contribute to this, his beautiful world. And every day I pray to God to show me what it is that God wants me to do. And so I believe that you do the same kind of prayer every day when you wake up in the morning and find out that you are still alive. You may not be as healthy as you would like to, but you are alive. And I pray that you'll ask God each day. Why and what is it that you want me to still do for you? What contribution do you want me to make in this, your great creation. Our time on earth is timed. We are not here forever. And so we pray, God Almighty, to anoint our lives so that we can leave a mark that is positive when our time comes, when we can join those who have gone before us. But the Bible also says that we may still be around when the Lord himself comes back for his second coming to bring completion on God's work. And when that happens, and if we are lucky to still be alive,
I can see you.
I pray that we will meet the Lord of joy and gratitude in our hearts. And so, my friends, welcome again for another opportunity that God has afforded us to join together in these virtual platforms in praise and worship to our God, and more especially in a time of meditating upon the Word of God. So today we are focusing on the book of Exodus chapter 17. Last week, we were looking at chapter 16. In that chapter 16 of the book of Exodus, we were reminded of the challenges, the struggles of the people of Israel as they flee from slavery in Egypt, headed to the promised land. They did not know which land was it, but God had promised them a better place for them right here on earth. And they were on the journey for that land. And boy, were they not confronted with obstacles and challenges. If you believe you have seen it all in your life, trust me, you have not seen it all. There are some challenges awaiting you ahead, but we did learn last week that when God is leading you away, challenges may arise, complications may be a part of your journey, insufficiency, hunger, even hunger and starvation may be a reality in your way. It may be a hunger and starvation, not necessarily a physical food. It could be hunger and starvation in other areas of your life. But in this particular case of chapter 16 that we looked at last week, it was an actual physical hunger and starvation. They had no more food supplies left to nourish them physically. But they had something that they could not see or contemplate, perhaps not fully understand. Why is it that if indeed God is involved, if God is real, if God is a part of the journey, why would we run out of food? If God is the one we learn about on the Bible, and the Bible tells us that God is not poor, God is not some kind of a miserable one. The Bible teaches us about a God who is powerful, all powerful for that matter. That means there is no other entity or individual or a body that possesses power that is greater than the power that God possesses. God is all omnipotent. And so why then is it that I do not seem to have everything I would dream of having? Why is it that I sometimes face the need, insufficiency of resources, material resources, financial resources? Why is it that I'm running out from time to time? Now, that chapter, chapter 16, that we looked at last week, taught us a thing or two in answer to that question, because they were running out of physical food. Their supplies were empty. There was nothing left. Nothing. See? Storages were empty. They were hungry. They needed food. But there was no food left anywhere. And now they were complaining and blaming the leader as usual, their pastor Moses, and so forth. But God delivered them. That's the lesson we learned last week. God did not let them starve to death. Maybe he wanted to teach them a lesson. Maybe he wanted to remind them of who God is and what God is capable of, and how God has unlimited resources. The very things that we run out of, including, not limited to, but including food, resources, if you will, both material and financial. When we run out of those resources, perhaps God wanted us to remember that we are to rely and to position our hearts not on the material or financial resources. Yes, our lives, in a way, depend and rely on those resources. Without them, we can't carry on this human life, can we? You need to eat in order to continue the journey of life. While that is true, and while it's also true that from time to time we do run out of these resources that sustain our physical human life, God wants us to remember that we have God, who is our heavenly parent, who is constantly and permanently providing for us, providing chances and opportunities, making a way for us. And ultimately, God wants us to know that it's not the resources and the money that we are to place our hearts on. We are not to wrap our hearts around money and resources materially. We are to do that with God, though. We are to wrap God around our hearts. We are to embrace and receive God fully in our lives. For it is God who is the source of all these things that we need. Remember what another scripture says in the Bible. That scripture says, first, seek God and God's kingdom. Once you have God and you have God's kingdom in your heart, the rest of the needs will be cared for. You see? Get the source of everything. You will have gotten everything you need. Everything you ever dreamed of. You already have it if you have God. Because God is the one who provides for the rest. You will never die of starvation and hunger. You'll never die in need if you have God in your heart. On the contrary, Jesus clarified, how much of a help is it for somebody who has all the material resources, all the money that the world can ever afford you, but you don't have the kingdom, you don't have life, you don't have God, therefore you don't have life. God is the kingdom of heaven. That kingdom we aspire to, we dream of, and we are longing to belong to. That is God. If you have God, you have everything you need right here on earth. And guess what? You have everything you could ever imagine. Because that's what we do about heaven. We only imagine. You have everything you'll ever imagine about heaven if you have God. Because Jesus is the way. And so we continue to explore and to learn out of the experiences of these people of Israel on their journey from slavery in Egypt, being liberated into the promised land where they would be free from being enslaved and where they would live life fully and enjoy life completely without being exploited by anyone. And so today we look at chapter 17. It is a continuation of the same lessons. Before we read this chapter 17, I want us to have a few things in mind which will help us to easily connect and easily understand the struggles that that these people were going through. Let us keep these questions in our minds as we listen to the reading and as we read ourselves, chapter 17 of the book of Exodus. Did these people of Israel who are being rescued, they are in the middle of a rescue operation. They are being set free, they are being liberated from the chains of slavery in Egypt. And they are being taken to a place that they are not really sure of. These people were all born in slavery, you know? So they don't really know. They have inherited the faith of their forefathers. They have heard about it. They may not have been perfect at practicing this faith while slavery and captives in Egypt. But God allowed them an extensive amount of time. Remember, last week we mentioned that it was not a direct flight. You know, it was a long flight. And in fact, it was not even a trip on an airplane or in a limo. It was not an easy trip on a comfortable means of transportation. No, there was no MTA transit there. There was no subway. You know, as much as you can criticize the New York City buses and subways, the means of transportation of the people of Israel were far much worse than this. So God really took them in a long road, in a hardship. It took them in a hardship. And so remember to place those questions in your mind as we read chapter 17 today. We are coming from chapter 16 last week, when they were running out of the physical food and God supplied free food to them in abundance. And now we are looking at chapter 17, which will tell us of their another physical need that they were running, they were going through. And so let us see whether they have learned anything at all from the lesson that God intended for them to learn on chapter 16 scenario that was described of us. Maybe they have learned something. Maybe now they trust God more and they show that in their attitudes and in their actions and in their communication with their pastor Moses Or maybe we will discover that they did not learn a single thing at all. And so that is what chapter 17 is gonna reveal to us today. But before we even go there, let us pause and pray to the Lord. Let us pray. Oh God, how could we just dive into your word as if we had power, control, and dominion of something that is not really ours? This is your word. Therefore, we come before you, before we tackle it in depth. We come to you to ask for an inspiration. We ask, Lord, that you may grant us enlightenment to both articulate your word, but most importantly, to understand it beyond just hearing it. We pray that, Lord, you will move through the mysterious ways that your Holy Spirit operates amongst us. You will move, O God, in our hearts and in our minds. Move, O Lord. We invite you to move. Bring that wave of your presence, the wave of your Holy Spirit, one that we cannot hear with our ears, and we can't really see it with our human eyes, but we desire that our spirits will connect with your Holy Spirit as your Holy Spirit moves within us to show us, to glorify for us, and to teach us a thing or two about today's scriptures as we read it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to read today, not from the African Jubilee edition, but I'm reading from one of my other favorite Bible translation, that is NIV. NIV. And this is what the Word of God says on chapter 17, the book of Exodus, verses 1 through 7. That's really the entire chapter. It's a short chapter. 1 through 17. Here is the reading of the Word of God from NIV Bible Translation. From the wilderness of Sin, Sin not the sin of wrongdoing. That is the name of the place. C-I-N. So from the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages. As the Lord commanded, they camped at Rephidim. But there was no water for the people to drink. There is another huge problem. There's no water. The people quarreled with Moses. That sounds familiar. They quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with these people? They are almost ready to stone me." And the Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile, and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock of Horeb, the rock of Horeb. Strike the rock, and water will come out of it, so that the people may drink. Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord amongst us or not? Is the Lord amongst us or not?" Oh my God, oh my God. Now, remember, I asked you to keep a few questions in your mind as you listen to the reading, or as you read from your own favorite Bible translation. And the main question you had to keep in mind while reading or simply listening to the reading of this chapter 17 was whether or not these people have learned anything about God from the chapter 16 story. Because the chapter 16 story happened first. And the chapter 17 story that we just read today, it is a follow-up. So on chapter 16, we learned that they first ran out of food. Apparently, they still had water supply, but they had no food. They cried out to God. And in their complaint process, it was really complicated because they seemed to be questioning the integrity of God. They are questioning the integrity of God's faithfulness. You see, God is faithful, and God never promised anything that God fails to fulfill. God said through Moses, "I have come for your freedom. I have heard your outcry for all those decades that you have been enslaved in Egypt. You have been crying out to me, and you may have thought or believed that I do not hear you, or I do not exist for that matter." You see, when you are suffering a lot, when you are going through hardship and challenges, believe me or not, you will cry out, and there will be a moment in your mind or even in your heart when you might think or even question for a second, "Does God really hear me? Is he even really there? How can I go through all these struggles, all these troubles and tribulations, if God is there for real? If God is everything the Bible is telling us about, why?" That question, why, it may be meaningless to God, but for us as human beings, it's a significant question. One of the most celebrated superstars in the Bible, they call him Job. They say that he was like a celebrity in that era during his lifetime. He had so much faith in God, so much faith, that it angered the devil. And the devil went to argue with God, make accusations to God that this man is not as faithful as you think. The only reason he seems to be so faithful to you is because of the children you gave him. He had a lot of children. You gave him children and they're all successful. If you did not give him any children, he wouldn't be this faithful to you. And God said, "Yeah, that's what you think. That's what you believe. Go ahead, take out all his children." And the devil went on and knocked down all the children. The man was grieved to death. Believe me, you have so many children and now you have none. Sometimes just one child that God gave you, and eventually you don't have that one child. How can you avoid asking that question, why? And now, after the devil took out all the children of Job, Job was believing even more and was even constantly in prayer to God. prayer is a connection, is the bridge that connects us with this divine power that we call God. When you feel weak, when you feel lost, and you go on your knees and you pray to God, you will receive from God the strength that you need. You'll feel strangely strong, even as you still go through the challenges that you are going through. That's what happens to me. Every time I feel weak, every time I feel debilitated, every time I feel like I can't even tell who I am anymore, and then I remember to go on my knees and I pray about it. Oh my God, you can't explain the power that just comes from God. Prayer is power, my friend. Now, that Job prayed like he had never prayed before, and he received a lot more strength from God. So the devil failed the test. You see, he couldn't break him. He couldn't break Job because of the children. Job was like, all the children came from God. It's God who gave to me. If God decided to take them back, so what? He went in prayers to God and say, you gave me that one child, and now that one child has died before me. I was looking forward for that child to prepare my burial and to bury me. And now that I'm the one who is burying my own child, my one child. You gave me all these children. I thought I was rich in my culture where I was born in Africa. Children are considered the wealth of the parent, not money or treasures or things. And now if I'm to stand from that advantage point and say, God, you gave me all these children or just this one child, that was my wealth, I was rich, and now you took them out? Never mind. I'm still rich if I have you, and I know you are in my life. Therefore, I will not kill myself or do anything crazy. I'm going to rely on you. That was the prayer that Job was saying. So the devil was humiliated. So he goes back, but the devil never gives up. Trust me. Devil never gives up. So the devil dares to go back to God and make another case. He said, oh, well, I see that he's still faithful. Job is still faithful to you. But I know the reason why. It's because of the material wealth and the money. The guy is rich. You blessed him overwhelmingly. I mean, who wouldn't praise you with that much wealth? And God said, oh, yeah, that's what you think. Go ahead and take out all of his possessions, but don't touch his life. And then the devil failed again because Job remained faithful to God in spite of all the physical and human losses. Remember what I just told you? The devil never gives up because the objective, the goal of the devil is to knock you down to your feet completely. So he goes back to God. This time he's negotiating Job's health. So, well, he lost all his children. That's a fact. He lost all his possessions and all his money. That's a fact. But there's something more important than that. The guy is healthy. The guy is healthy. Why don't you authorize me to go back to him and devastate his body? Literally speaking, he's going to give up faith. He's going to give up faith on you. God said, yeah, that's what you think. Go ahead. Knock down his health, but don't you dare touch his life. And the devil went running, couldn't wait. 1 hour is a headache. The next time is the ear, the left ear, and the right ear, the nose, and the Marfan, everything, every cell in his body was aching. They say on the description that that man was like a living dead, something that is still alive, but is actually dead, physically dead, stinking. You couldn't stand. Job, who was rich, both in wealth, in finances, and in children, now he is without any single child left. He's childless. And he's without any money, no single possession, none, no livestock, nothing at all, nothing. He's completely poor. He is in a miserable condition. He's totally undesirable as a person. And he's not just sick. He is like physically dead, except that he's still breathing. So they can't take him to the cemetery. He's breathing. The man is breathing. They're not going to bury you if you are breathing. See? But he sustained one thing very important. He sustained God in his heart. Oh my gosh. If you have God, you have everything. If you have everything without God, you have nothing. That's what the Bible says. The people of Israel, they are in a journey of their life. This journey is going to mark a huge difference in their existence as a people and as individual families. They are going, they are moving, they are traveling, they are on a journey, and they are on the desert. There's no highway, there's no easy way, and there's no quick fix. God wants them to learn lessons about God. God wants these people of the promise, people of the promised land, to develop a relationship with him. God wants them not to deceive themselves about who God is and about who they are. God wants them to know that they are absolutely nothing, nothing, nada in Spanish, nothing without God. God wants them to know that they are only something, anything, if they have their God. Without their God, they are nothing and they are nobody. That lesson began on chapter 16 and it is repeated on chapter 17 and really throughout the book of Exodus. If you are a lover of Bible reading, I will encourage you to read that entire book of Exodus. Any chance you get, just read from chapter 1 all the way. You will learn a lot from who God is and who God wants us to be. Our God is really amazing. You think you know God? I thought so many times that I know God. And so many times I found myself to be wrong. You know? Even up to this day, I don't know who God is. I'm a student. I'm a number one student. And it's really a life study about God. The moment you think you know God, you'll discover that very moment that you actually didn't know God. And then you begin again to learn the journey. If you are like me, don't give up. Just keep learning. Keep learning about God. Keep seeking that relationship, keep trying to grow with God. And you know, if you feel like you really don't know God, you thought you knew God, but you don't know him, based on any particular experience of your life, or of your health, or of your family life, or your family health, or whatever it is that is you are learning from, just know that all those are just episodes of life. God gives us episodes, and out of those episodes, we draw lessons, and they help us to know who God is. On chapter 16, last week, we discussed the fact that they were running out of physical food. That is indispensable for human life. You can't sustain human life without eating. You have to eat. If you can't eat, the doctors will find a way to channel food into your body so that blood can continue to be produced and to run through your veins and distributing all the vitamins all over, the nutrients that come from food all over your body, so you can remain alive. You need that in order for your body to be alive. So they will make a way to bring food inside you, even without you being able to chew that food and to swallow. The doctors, with this advanced science, they will find a way. And they will tell you, oh, give him some soup, something liquidish. It doesn't require too much chewing. If you can't even stand that, they will find a way to bring food directly to your veins. But you need to have food. And they were running out of food. And God taught them the lesson that what they needed was not physical food. What they needed was God. Because God has everything. And God proved them that God was not running out of food. They were running out of food supply, but God had plenty. How do I know that? I know that because of the way God dealt with their hunger and starvation situation. God did not give them only the portion they needed to eat. God gave them an overwhelming amount of food that just fell down from the skies to the surface, exactly where they were. That food, throughout the history of humanity, was not registered anywhere else on the planet Earth where manna fell down on that particular day. No, there was no record of that. There's no record of that. That food fell directly where that group of people was, at the desert. But the quantity of food that fell was overwhelmingly unnecessary. It's more than what they needed. Number two, remember again from chapter 16 lesson last week, God gave them specific instructions. He said, each person who is answering for his or her family is to go outside the tent and collect only enough quantity for that person and all the members of the family to eat and finish that day. Do not take more than you need for that one meal. Not just even for a day, for just for a meal, because there were enough for the number of meals that they needed. Breakfast, be it lunch or dinner, it was sufficient. And God said, take only enough for that particular meal each time. Don't take more than you need. In other words, do not lose trust in me and try to accumulate more than you need because of your distrust, just in case he might forget or something might happen with this God. I don't want to starve again. They had starved enough. They knew the pain of starvation. And so they were rightly in a position of being tempted to take more because of the experience of starvation. But God instead wants them to trust God enough in spite of the experience of starvation. God wants them to trust the fact that God will indeed supply for the next meal when that time comes. Even though that food came from heaven, that food followed the normal rules of nature. You eat something, they say that that food will satisfy you for about 4 hours. After that amount of time, you will feel hungry again. Well, you may not starve like starving to death, but you will feel the need to eat something after 4 hours. Some people a little sooner than that, others a little later than that, but that's the average time that food will be digested and you might need to eat something else, some snacks or something. You see, we have to keep eating something to keep our body active and energetic. God wants them to trust in him. But when you feel hungry again, God will feed you again. Even though you have nothing left, you have no supplies stored somewhere. But we as human beings, we gain security when we see that we have things. We can touch them, they are here. When we know that we have money in the bank. Okay? That our security is drawn out of physical things that we can say, okay, I have my bottle of water. I have my bottle of water here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I have more left. So I'm secure, I'm safe. To the end of this class, I'm gonna have more water to drink if I need it. It's right here. You hear the noise? That's water, it's there. So I'm safe, I'm secure, I'm confident. I am at peace. If I don't see this bottle of water, and if I shake it, I don't feel water inside there, then I am disturbed. But God wants me to trust that God is the one who supplied this water. Even if I would run out of this water, there will be more water. And trust me, there had been times that my finances were kind of shaky. And you know, I don't really drink water from the tub for as much as I can. That is the very last resort if I have to drink water from the tub. I have taught myself to buy water and drink that water from the bottle. How did I teach myself that? Because the first time I came to the United States, I came to New York. And I asked my colleague, I said, is the water safe to drink? And he said, oh, yeah. This is New York, okay? This is not Africa. This is New York. In America, everything is safe. Everything is perfect. Everything, nothing here is going to make you sick. And I believed him. So I drank the water from the tub. It might have been a coincidence. Because people drink water from the tub and nothing happens to them. But for some reason, I could not sleep that night. I was sick like hell all night long. It all began because of that water. And from that moment on, I said, you know what? I'm just going to buy my water and feel safe and drink water and feel safe. That's what I've been doing since. And water is very expensive. So there are times when I run out of money to buy water. And I become like those Israelites that we are talking about. But I will tell you a story, and believe me, every time I run out of water and I'm running out of my money to buy water. I open my door and there are cases, not just one case, cases of water. An angel of the Lord came, I don't know from where, and just placed water there on my gate, and the water is there. I never run out of water. God is teaching me the same lesson that is teaching the Israelites. There is water supply. There is food supply every time. Now, on the chapter 17, that's one that we are closing with today. On the chapter 17, the same thing was repeated, but this time is water. Now, on chapter 16, God delivered water directly from heaven. Okay? They could see the manna falling down. This time, however, the difference is that God is instructing Moses to use the natural resources. It is still God bringing this water, but the way God is supplying this miraculous water this time is by incorporating divine intervention with nature. Nature, the things that God has already put in place right here around us. And God said, take that stick that I commanded you once to use to strike the water, and the water made a way in the Nile, and now there was some kind of a dry construction of highway that people of Israel could literally walk on and walk through and cross the sea to the other side. Now use that same stick. But this time you're gonna strike a rock. God did not direct Moses to find a river, a lake, or a sea. God said, go and strike a rock. That's kind of strange, a rock. I mean, who would have known that God could bring water into being out of a rock? A stone, dry, huge, big, a mountain of a rock? That's exactly what God did. He said to Moses, use that stick that you have in your hand. Prove that you have faith in me. Put your faith into action. Believe my words. Take your stick and hit a rock, and water will come out. Moses did that, and it happened exactly as God had predicted. There was enough water, a spring of water, a river of water in a desert. They had more than they needed. I only need a little bit of borrowed water to drink at a time. But God brought in an endless stream of water in a desert. And now they all have water, not only to drink, but also to take shower and do laundry. You know, if they wanted to turn that desert into a little garden, they could, because it is all about water. It is the water that does the magic. Life comes from water. Now, second component of that lesson there is not just about God being faithful to provide the resources that we need when we feel like we are poor, we are broke or what. There is another spiritual component there that I wanted to bring to your attention. Remember, this time, God is bringing physical water, H2O. That's the scientific code for water. H number 2, and number 0. God brought in that water out of a rock, and their physical thirst was met. Here's the spiritual link that is both prophetic and amazing, simply put. Prophetic in that it speaks to the Son of God that had been prophesied to them as the Messiah, the one who would come to bring eternal life to all of us, who would come as a redeemer and a liberator, not from physical slavery and hardship and labor, unpaid for labor and exploitation and all of that. That too, but most importantly, the spiritual liberation from hell, really, from hell. Through Jesus Christ, God brings a stream of the living water. That living water is not even the physical water that Jesus was talking about to the woman on the wall. Remember the story of the famous story of the woman on at the well. That woman in dialoguing with the Lord, she did not know who the Lord is. She was just seeing a guy sitting there. But in the midst of their conversation, her spiritual eye, her spiritual sight was opened. And she began to connect with the Lord. She began to realize that she was sitting around the presence of the kingdom of God. She began to contemplate the fact that she was actually dialoguing with the child of God. And so she grew in curiosity and she asked questions. And when she realized that, no, this has to be the Lord. There's no way a guy can talk the way this one is talking, can connect with my spirit the way this one is talking. And so she decided to rush back to her neighborhood, and she brought down the entire village and now she's like, hear for yourself, see for yourself. And the people indeed, as they engaged with the Lord in that communication, I mean, the Lord was busy now attending to the flock. And the people themselves got to the point where that woman had gotten in her own conversation and interaction with the Lord. And the people said the equivalent to what the woman was saying to them in the village when she was convincing them to come down. And the people said, we don't need you anymore, woman. We don't need you to preach to us anymore. We don't need your Bible study any longer. We have seen it for ourselves. We understand it for ourselves. Indeed, this is the Lord. Isn't it so beautiful? When your faith can grow up to the level where you don't need anybody to tell you nothing any longer. You don't need to be bothered by any sermons or Bible studies any longer. You don't need to be bothered by any Bible reading and meditating anymore. You're already there. Because what the Bible is doing and what the preachers and all these teachers and all this religion is trying to do, this Christianity, is to usher us into that corner, into that position, into that seat, into that place, a full, total clarity. When you see things for yourself, everything becomes like, in the middle of a dark room, somebody has switched the light. And now everything's so clear, you see so clearly. That's the place that the woman was taken to by the Lord. And that is the same place when the people she evangelized to, and they followed her, and they met the Lord, they interacted with the Lord, And out of that interaction, they were taken to the same place, a place of clarity. And they said, indeed, this is the Lord. Not that when the time for the Lord came for him to leave them, they begged Jesus to stay with them a little longer. They said, no, please stay with us. I'm telling you, when you get to that place, I dare you will not want to leave that place. It is a good place. It is a place of peace. It is a place of love. It is a place of joy, an inner joy. You may still be sick. You may still be dealing with that problem. You may be still dealing with whatever the situation, but I'm telling you, when you reach that place on your interaction of faith with the Lord, you will have inner peace that you will not want anything to take that peace away from you. The people had their water, their bottles were filled and refilled without having to pay for it. And that water was better than the one that I spend my money buying every time I want to drink water. You see? But the real water that water from the desert was prophesying about was the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. The water and the rock was not that physical stone, huge mountain of stone that they call rock in English. The one that the Lord commanded Moses to use his stick to touch it, and the water suddenly, halalala, began to spring out of. That rock was a symbol, was a prophecy, was a sign of the body of Christ. You see, the body of Christ is the rock. And the blood that come out of that rock, of that body of Christ, that blood is the water that washes away our sins. And once our sins are washed away, we are absolutely, even though we are still here in this physical world today, the world where faith is required to sustain us, even though we're still here in this, under this physical body that is filled with illnesses and all kinds of trouble, even though we're still here in Brooklyn, here in America, here on planet Earth, here on the physical world, living on the physical realm, that blood of Jesus, that water of the blood of Jesus, when you drink it, it washes away your spiritual sins that cannot be taken care of by physical water or food. That blood of Jesus, my friend, no wonder the Lord himself instructed the believers to repeat it over and over, over and over. Here at St. Mark's United Methodist Church, every first Sunday is a go Sunday. What does that mean? It means it's a Sunday that nobody wants to miss the opportunity of being in church in person, because we want to gather around the table of the Lord and share the communion and share the symbols that the Lord has left with us. When we take the piece of bread, and when we take a little bit of a drink from the fruits of the vine, and we say the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, which has been given unto you, let it strengthen your faith, revive your body, and revive you spiritually to continue the long journey ahead of you until you get to that place when the switch has been turned on. There's no more fear, no more doubt, and nothing else messing with you. It is total salvation. Oh my God. It is better than Canaan. Those people of Israel, were longing to arrive to their destination in Canaan. God had said that in that place, there was manna and honey. Everything was perfect in that place. But let me tell you something. I truly wonder whether that generation of Israelites is already in that place, in that canon, the spiritual canon that all of us are contemplated and included in. That's what we call, in other words, heaven. That's the really actual canon that God is liberating us from our slavery to sin to a life everlasting in heaven. Oh my God. I love every chance, every opportunity I get to sit down with you saints and just interact, fellowship, and meditate around the Word of God. The Word of God is powerful. It is the source of our strength. Don't you ever, ever, and don't let nothing shake your faith to the point of looking on the other side. Look on the direction of Jesus Christ. Look at God, and God will see your hunger. God who sees your thirst, both physical and spiritual. God will liberate you. God will free you. And God will take you to that place. Amen. Amen. Thank you, my friends. Thank you, beloved. Let us bow in prayer. I always like to send you forth in a prayer. Let us pray. Lord, I bless these, your saints. I bless these, your children, your daughters and sons, young and old. I bless them in your name. Thank you, O God. Thank you for what you are doing in our life. And thank you for what you are doing through and out of our lives as you use us as a blessing to somebody else, to other people around us. We thank you, Lord. Our life is you. Our food is in you. Our water is in you. Everything that we need is in your hands. Help us to see you, to hear you, to interact and to fellowship with you, and we will be satisfied. We will be content. We will be happy. We will be joyful with the kind of happiness that nothing, not even physical illnesses, can take away from us. We bless your name as I bless all the families that are represented here. Those who are listening from hospitals and nursing homes, rehab centers, even from their own homes, while they are not feeling well. Their health is not in a good place. I especially pray for them, Lord, that you will continue to administer to them. Continue, O God, to minister health unto their bodies. Bless us, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. May God bless you. And I look forward to see you all on Sunday. This is our communion Sunday. And I pray that the Lord will give you enough strength to be there. God bless you. Buenas noches. Good night. And bye-bye.